Whole Story Quest Audiobooks presents This Little Piggy by Rob Ashman. Narrated by Nicholas Camm. Preface. As you watch your life drain away, I want you to remember one thing. I never wanted any of this. I was the man with a wife and kids who lived in a house, went to work every morning, and enjoyed the occasional holiday. But that was never enough. You made that clear. You lined up for your pound of flesh, and one by one tore apart the building blocks of my life. You each took a piece, shredded the goodness from it, and handed it back. Then laughed in my face as I crumbled to dust. Life is all about change, and things are about to get worse. Much worse. You know who you are. You all know who you are. But what you don't know is, it's time to make the piggies squeal. Chapter 1. Bloody hell, this is a He dances at the end of my arm as I jab the metal pins into his stomach, sending his central nervous system into meltdown. His face resembles a landed carp, mouth gaping open as his muscles go into spasm. He topples back into the hallway, landing face up on the parquet floor. His body jolts and convulses at my feet. I step across the welcome mat and into the house, closing the door behind me. I unzip my bag, rummage around, and bring out a handful of thick black cable ties. I roll him onto his front, securing his wrists tight behind his back and bind his feet together at the ankles. He continues to jerk and spasm as I straddle him. I reach forward and ram a tea towel into his mouth, shoving it past his teeth with my thumb until his cheeks bulge. I tie it into place with a length of cord knotted behind his head. I step off him, pull a white coverall from the bag and slip it on, zipping the front right up to my neck. The hood covers my head and the drawstrings pull the material tight around my face. Next, I don a pair of overshoes and gloves. The hallway is large, and straight ahead through an archway I can see the ornate staircase. It leads to the first floor, then splits left and right. A series of bedrooms run along the landing. I take my bag, walk through the arch, up the stairs, and circle back on myself until I'm stood directly above the foot of the stairs. I remove a chain block and a coil of thick rope and feed the rope through the balustrade. I tie it off and lower the chain block down to the first step. I head downstairs into the hallway, where the man is twisting and turning on his front. I kneel beside him, and he cranes his neck to look at me, screaming through the gag. I take my new toy and hold it up for him to see. It crackles, and he goes berserk, trying to roll over. I ram the pins into his back, and he once again does the million-volt dance. I grab him by his feet and drag his twitching body through the arch and along the carpet, dumping him at the bottom of the stairs. I bind a heavy leather strap from my bag around his ankles and snap the carabiner in place. The links chink through the pulley block as I yank on the chain, raising him feet first into the air. The metallic sound resonates off the walls as I continue to raise him up. His hips come clear of the floor. His body weight takes over, and he swings, hitting his head on the bottom step. I hoist him over it and press the stop lock. He sways back and forth, suspended upside down from the first floor balustrade. He is coming around, rotating slowly in midair. I take the knives from the bag and set to work. He jerks when he sees the blades. Now a different sound bounces off the walls, muffled screams and choking. I brush past him and climb three steps, grasping the hem of his trouser leg. He freezes. The point of the scalpel pierces the denim, and I slice downwards, severing the material until it gapes open to reveal his underwear. I do the same with the other leg. The material falls to his crotch. I reach for the hunting knife. The heavy blade makes short work of the waistband, and in two cuts his jeans and boxer shorts hit the carpet. I grab his shirt collar, cutting through the cotton at the back. This time he bucks and spins, swinging wildly on the hoist. It makes no odds, and the shirt is soon hanging in two pieces. I cut into the cuff, and in one slash the sleeve comes away. I do the same with the other. He yelps when the razor blade scores his skin. I walk back down the stairs to replace the knives in the bag. He is staring at me, bug-eyed, suspended by his ankles, completely naked apart from his socks. Well, a man has to have some dignity. I make my way into the kitchen and root around in the cupboards for the biggest pots I can find. I fill them with water and load up the six-ring hob. The gas burners have a satisfying hiss as they crank up the heat. They're much better than the camping stove I was forced to use last time. I leave the cooker and return to the bottom of the stairs. The man is making a right commotion. His cock and balls are flapping around as he jackknifes his body, yelling at the top of his voice. As much as that is possible with a mouth crammed full of toweling. He's going to hurt himself if he's not careful. I reach into the bag and pull out a 3-inch square black box with a rotary dial on the top and wires dangling from terminals on two sides. I remove a plug from the wall socket and replace it with my own. The man stops making a fuss and watches me. The red LED on the box tells me we have liftoff, and I sit cross-legged in front of him. His eyes are the size of snooker balls popping out of his face. I attach a sticky pad to his left temple and another to his right. He flails his head around, but it's no use. He screams and resumes his jackknife acrobatics. I flick the toggle switch and the green LED comes on. My fingers ease the dial off the zero backstop, and the screaming intensifies. The dial goes all the way up to 10. By the time I reach 3, he will be much calmer. Chapter 2. Acting DCI Ros Kray nosed her car into the driveway of 16 Farnham Close and came to an abrupt halt. Two police cars and the crime scene investigation van were blocking her path. The doors to the van were open and a white boiler-suited person was leaning into the back. Kray jumped from her car and flashed her warrant card at the sergeant holding a clipboard and pulled on a similar coverall and overshoes. She drew the zip all the way up to the top, hoping it would keep out the cold. She hated October. It heralded the onset of dark nights and cold mornings at a time when the roads were teeming with tourists. The arrival of over 1 million lights spread across 6 miles of coastline was enough to ram Blackpool until it was bursting at the seams. A tradition that had come a long way from when it had consisted of 8 carbon arc lamps and when it was billed as the greatest show on earth. They convinced the world it was artificial sunshine. She also hated it because the 18th day of the month marked the anniversary when Rampton stuck a knife into her husband's neck and took his life. Today's date was the 17th. October was a shit month. Standing in the doorway of the house was Mitch, her favourite coroner's office doctor. He was approaching 50 with a bald head and a straining waistline. He was old school and well respected. His style was businesslike and to the point, bordering on rude. But that was just the way Kray liked it. He always wore the facial expression of somebody who had just stepped in dog shit. But this morning, even from this distance, the look on his face said, "This is bad." Kray felt the gravel crunch beneath her feet as she walked up to the imposing double-fronted property. She ran the numbers in her head. "This sized house in this type of neighbourhood got to be pushing £1 million plus." "Morning, Ros," Mitch said in his usual, "I got a sore throat voice." "Mitch," Kray replied, I hear you got acting DCI. Congratulations. Yeah, though I'm not sure congratulations is the word I would use. Have you spoken to Jackson? No. DCI Jackson had been her fuckwit of a boss before he signed himself onto the sick with stress, claiming the behaviour of ACC Mary Quaid as the reason for his breakdown. In Cray's view, the two were made for each other. He was bloody useless and she was a corporate sadist with epaulets. It was a match made in heaven. How have you been since you got back to work? Mitch asked. Oh, you know, plodding on, putting things behind me. Anyway, since Jacko's wheels fell off, I haven't had 2 minutes to myself, let alone time to dwell on things. And from the look on your face, you're not about to make that any easier. I'm afraid not. He beckoned her over the threshold into a cavernous hallway with long tapestry curtains framing the windows and pictures on the wall. What have we got? Cray asked, taking in the opulence. Take a look. Mitch waved his pudgy hand. Behind him, through the archway, she could see a naked body, suspended upside down by his ankles, hanging at the base of the stairs. She pulled on a pair of blue medical gloves. Mitch continued. His name is John Archibald Graham, 54 years of age, lived here for 10 months or so. She stood under the arch, the ornate chandelier hanging from the ceiling above sprayed pockets of bright light across the walls, giving the place a dance hall feel. The kitchen, lounge and office led off from the space like the spokes of a wheel. 10 feet in front of her, the grey carpet gave way to a dark brown colour. Stretching out along the floor was a patchwork of 12-inch square aluminium checker plates with corrugated tops. The stench of oxidizing metal filled her senses. Cray made her way towards the body, stepping carefully on the plates. She came to the break in the carpet where the colour changed. Is that blood? Yes, it is. By the size of our vic, I would estimate about 13 pints. Any prints in the carpet? Only the size fives of the housekeeping lady who found him at 8:30 this morning when she turned up to do a little light dusting. She sat in the front room on her fourth cup of tea, still in shock. Not surprised. This is way above her pay grade to clear up. Roz reached the bottom of the stairs and stared at the dead man. His arms were secured behind his back with black cable ties, and the edges of what looked like a tea towel were poking from the corners of his mouth. His eyes stared straight ahead, crazed red with ruptured blood vessels. His face was the colour of uncooked pastry, but the rest of his body was red raw. Cray sniffed the air. "Not only blood," she called out to Mitch. "No, I think there is urine soaked into the carpet as well." Cray flicked on a pencil torch and the piercing beam sliced into the translucent face. She moved the cone of light over his chest, stomach and genitals. Patches of skin were missing while in other areas large blisters covered the flesh. "What the hell is this?" Cray asked. "Some sort of burning, not sure with what, but it was hot enough to cause the skin to peel away." "Fuck," Cray said under her breath as she trailed the cone of white light around the body. "And this?" she asked, shining the torch onto what looked like confetti on the stairs. "I think it's skin," replied Mitch. "There are 2 circular burn marks on each temple, and the jugular vein on the right-hand side has been severed." Cray shifted her position to see the single stab wound to the victim's neck, and 2 circular blemishes stood out black against the colourless skin. "By the look of the blood spatter against the balustrade, he was stabbed when he was still alive," Cray said. "Yes, it looks like arterial flow." "Do you have a cause of death?" "Exsanguination. Whatever happened to him beforehand didn't kill him. He was alive when his jugular was severed. His heart was still beating and pumped his blood onto the floor." Cray looked around at the extent of the discoloured carpet. "I reckon it took more than 9 pints and a full bladder to make this mess." She dabbed her index finger into pile and held it to her nose. "What's the deal with him being stripped naked, apart from his socks?" Cray tipped her head towards the ceiling. "Don't know. Until we get him down and conduct a thorough examination, there are a lot of unanswered questions." "The carpet on the stairs is wet, but not from blood. Any ideas?" Not yet. We've taken a sample away for analysis. Got a time of death? Best estimate at this stage is between 8 p.m. and midnight yesterday. The first officer on the scene reported there was no sign of a forced entry. Does the maid have her own key, or does he leave one out for her? Wilder acting, DCI Cray. I think you'll find that's your job. Mitch called over his shoulder as he walked out into the hallway. Thanks for that. She's going to take a bit to unravel. Cray stood up and was about to retrace her steps when something caught her eye on the banister. She clicked on her penlight and shone the beam onto the wooden handrail to her right. Did you see this? She called after Mitch. See what? Looks like blood on the banister. The torch beam illuminated the dark red smear. No, I missed that. Is it a hand or a shoe print? Now whose job are we talking about? Cray stared at the blood. After what felt like an age, Mitch broke the silence. What is it? Why would there be blood this high up? Cray muttered under her breath. What? What did you say? Oh, nothing. I was just talking to myself. Cray negotiated her way out along the checker plates, through the archway, and stood on the front step, breathing in fresh air. Her mobile was pressed against the side of her head. Hey, Duncan, can you get a team down to 16 Farnham Close ASAP? She paused, allowing space for the usual questions. When you're here, you can see for yourself. It's not pretty. She hung up and marched back to the car to await reinforcements. The scar on her right shoulder tingled. What the hell is blood doing up there?
Chapter 3.
There was so much blood. I knew John was a big man, but come on. He bled out so much I thought I might drown. When I pulled the knife out of his neck, a torrent hit the woodwork, which I have to admit was a relief because I thought I'd overdone it. I had sat on the floor in front of him, turned the dial onto setting number one, and he went berserk, bucking wildly at the end of the chain. I slipped the pointer onto setting number two, and he jackknifed at the waist, nearly catching me in the face with his head. I was forced to duck out of the way as he twisted and turned like a fish on a line. It was a good job he lived in a detached house because the tea towel stuffed into his mouth was doing a shit job. I shifted the pointer to number four, and his body went as stiff as a board. I watched as the whites of his bulging eyes burst into crazy paving, the tiny blood vessels rupturing with the pressure in his head. Then something unexpected happened. I glanced up to see an erect penis jutting out above me. It was pulsing up and down. That's a bit rude. After 15 seconds, I rotated the dial to the off position and disconnected it from the wall. I returned to the kitchen to see if the gas rings had done their job. One by one, I carried the pots through and placed them on the stairs. His erection had thankfully shriveled into a fleshy blob. I squeezed through the gap between him and the banister to sit on the stairs. I pulled my knife from its sheath on my belt and plunged it into his neck. He didn't flinch. That's when I thought, fuck it, he's dead. But I needn't have worried. When I yanked the blade free, his heart pumped a rhythmic stream of blood onto the stairs, the initial spurt hitting the balustrade. My lovely reminiscence is shattered by the waitress banging my breakfast down onto the table along with a glass of tap water. Order number 17, she smiles. 17 other people have had breakfast here this morning. I smile back. 17 other people? But it's a shithole. I remove the small Tupperware container from my coat pocket, flip the lid and line them up on the table. The round one, the white one, and the yellow capsule. To be taken once a day with food. I pick them up in turn and pop them into my mouth, swilling them down with the water. A daily ritual, which I am still not used to. I peel back the top of the croissant and give it a squirt of tomato ketchup. A bacon and egg croissant, French and English breakfast cuisine collide in a holiday resort on the west coast of Britain. How very continental. I squash down the pastry top and take a bite. Despite its appearance, it actually tastes quite good. I stare out of the window across the promenade and out to sea. I know there is an array of wind turbines off the coast, but the murk and mist cloaks them from my view. It's October, and you don't come to Blackpool for the weather in October. The illuminations are in full swing, and the town is bouncing. The hotels are crammed full of families, and the trams are bursting with people going, ooh and ah. Children walk about with their necks permanently craned back looking to the sky, while the pleasure beach and piers are a buzzing hive of noisy activity at night. Well, when I say night, it gets dark at 3 p.m. I sip my second espresso of the day. I reckon I could drink 10 of these and not get any higher than I feel right now. Though there is one thing that is spoiling an otherwise perfect morning. The mouth of the road was cordoned off with yellow tape and guarded by a uniformed officer sporting a pissed-off face and a high-vis jacket. I had fancied treating myself to a drive-by, but it was not to be. The police were already on the scene and the street was in lockdown. Hence, winding up here, enjoying a mad fusion of continental cuisine for breakfast while gazing out of the window onto, well, fuck all, really. I check my watch. I need to get a move on. I swallow the last of the bacon, drink the dregs from the cup and pay my bill. The young woman gives me the same smile as she had done earlier and wishes me a good day. If only she knew. I elbow open the door, stepping out into the cold wind. I don't mind it. I find it exhilarating. But then I am on such a high, I would find catching my bollocks in a drawer an exhilarating experience, to be honest. My car is across the street, and in 10 strides I am sitting behind the wheel with the hot air blowers warming my legs. I pull away into the empty road and head off. The town soon melts away into the countryside as I drive over the chaos of the M6 heading for Inglewhite. I've never been there, even though I have travelled this route many times, because a mile and a half before the village I take a sharp left onto a narrow lane. Soon the road becomes a single track, which winds its way between the hedgerows and dry stone walls. The route becomes narrower and narrower, with overhanging foliage grabbing at my car from both sides. Sections of tarmac have lifted away, making the wheels bounce and scrape against the hard core below. After half a mile, I edge through a set of 5-bar gates onto a derelict farm. I have no idea what type of business this farmer was conducting, but all I can say is he can't have been very good at it. The place has laid empty for years. I park at the back of a large barn and snatch my bag from the footwell of the passenger seat. To the side of the building is the farmhouse, or more accurately, a collection of half walls and tumbled-down roofs where the farmhouse used to be. I walk to the back of the barn to an underground storage facility that used to house wood and coal. I unzip the holdall and retrieve the white coverall suit, overshoes and gloves. I drop them into the old rusting brazier bolted against the wall and squirt a generous amount of lighter fluid on top. The match ignites on the third strike, and the sweet smell of sulphur fills my senses. There is a woofing sound as the fluid-soaked material bursts into flames. I stare into the fire dancing in the bin and can see John's eyeballs bursting in their sockets, the electrical current frying his brain. The clothes burn bright against the gloom. His skin is peeling away while his lifeless body hangs limp and white. Pretty soon the flames subside. I poke at the smouldering embers with a stick to mix them with the burned remnants at the bottom. I check my watch. I've got a few more things to take care of, and I don't want to be late. Chapter 4. Kray bounded up the stairs to her office. For a woman who smoked enough cigarettes to kill 3 people and only ate enough to keep a 6-year-old alive, she was surprisingly sprightly. Detective Duncan Taverner had taken over the reins at the house, which had allowed her to get back to the station to make a dent in the avalanche of paperwork that had descended on her. She reached her desk and her shoulders dropped. Stuck to her phone was a post-it note. ACC Quaid wants to see you as soon as you get in. Kray tore the note off the phone, screwed it up and tossed it into the waste paper bin. She looked at the neat piles of correspondence stacked on the round conference table. How the hell did Jacko get through all of this and do his job? Oh, but hang on. He didn't do his bloody job, did he? Kray did as she was told and sloped off to the 3rd floor, where the top brass lived, stopping first to arrange the pens in an orderly fashion at the right-hand side of her desk. She did the same with the pencils on the left-hand side. That's better. The 3rd floor smelled of wax furniture polish and air freshener. Kray nodded to the gaggle of PAs busying themselves booking meetings and lunch appointments and made a beeline for the end office. She knocked on the open door and walked in. ACC Mary Quaid was the only person on the ACPO floor who made her desk look small. She looked up and smiled as if Santa had just walked in. "Roz, good to see you. Come in and take a seat." Kray gritted her teeth. She was so preoccupied with keeping her feelings in check she missed the collection of pens and pencils sitting in the same pot. "I got a message you wanted to see me, ma'am," she said when her teeth had finally unclenched themselves. "Yes, messy business, I hear, at Farnham Close." "It is. I have a team out at the house and we will know more when they do the post-mortem and get the forensics back."
"Good work.
I wanted to say," Kray zoned out. She knew what Kray wanted to say. It was the same bloody thing she always wanted to say. Kray spun her wedding ring round and round. It wasn't long ago that Quaid had wanted to drum her out of the force, and now, since Kray had returned to work, she was behaving like a long-lost friend. Kray zoned back in.
"So, you see, I wanted you to know that you have my full support. You must think of me as your..."
Quaid was banging on. "Friend, trusted colleague, confidant. I don't fucking think so." Kray had zoned out again. When the full details surrounding the Jason Strickland case had emerged, Quaid had gone into damage limitation mode. The officers from Internal Inquiries and IPPC were all over them like a dose of the clap. Kray was on sick leave following the injury she had sustained at the hands of Strickland, but she fully participated in their inquiry. After all, she needed to know they were getting her side of the story. Kray had found herself the main focus of attention for the initial part of the investigation, but then, given her actions, that was hardly a surprise. Her vague recollections, coupled with her plea of self-defense, had carried the day. It was not hard to convince them. After all, she had killed a man who had the faces of 2 dead women in his freezer, a dead man in his basement, and kept a venomous snake in a fish tank. Kray didn't need to pull off an Oscar-winning performance. The decision to believe her side of the story kind of made itself. Quaid had done a remarkable job of shifting the entire blame onto DCI Jackson. Despite the fact that she had been the one calling the shots, Jackson hadn't stood a chance. After all, it would not have gone down well for such a senior officer to be found guilty of professional incompetence, especially one who ticks so many boxes on the diversity scale. No, carrying the can was Jackson's job, and Quaid had made sure the investigation buried him. Hence, Jacko was now on the sick, no doubt talking to his Federation rep on a daily basis, and Kray had been made up to acting DCI. To add to her woes as head of CID, Kray now had the delights of DI Colin Brownlow to manage. He was knee-deep in a missing persons case and making heavy work of it. Kray knew sooner or later she would have to step in, but for now, let him get on with it. Under normal circumstances, their relationship before could best be described as distant disdain. Now Kray had the acting role, it was open hostility. From Brownlow's side, anyway. He thought he should have been given the job due to his seniority and length of service. The top brass felt being good at your job was a far better recruitment criterion and had given it to Kray. Funny how things turn out. Kray zoned back in again. So, if there is anything you need, Ros, you come to me. You are a credit to the force and a brilliant detective. I'm proud of you, and so is the chief.
That's funny. You weren't saying that when you're fucking suspending me.
Of course, ma'am, Kray responded. It's good to know you have my back on this one.
Good. Anything you need, Ros, you know where I am.
Quaid heaved her ample frame from her chair to signal the meeting was over. Kray nodded and left the office.
Know where you are? You block out the sun, how the fuck could I miss you?
Back at her desk, Kray had signed off the overtime rota and authorised a batch of expenses. Her unread emails stood at 380, and she had switched off the inbox alert because it was driving her nuts. She leaned back into her chair, stretching her arms towards the ceiling. Her mind drifted back to the house with the body suspended in the stairway. Buried beneath her expensive makeup, the 1.5-inch ridge that ran along her left cheekbone began to tingle. The dark red line made by Rampton's Stanley knife was itching, telling her something wasn't right. The more she wandered through the house, the more it yelled at her. She gathered up her keys, snatched her phone from the desk and pressed two buttons.
Hello? Hello? Duncan, are you there? Can you hear me?
There was a pause on the line and the sound of someone talking underwater. Kray bustled out of her office and down the stairs.
That's better. Yes, I can. Have they taken down the body?
She said, hurrying from the building and across the car park.
Good. Don't let them do it until I get there.
She threw herself into her car and powered into the flow of traffic. The scars that crisscrossed her body weren't tingling. They were on fire. Kray swung the car into number 16 and hit the brakes, skidding to a stop in the empty driveway. She jumped from the car, pulled on her forensic gear and ran to the front door, only to meet Taverner coming the other way. Taverner was a high flyer, exhaustively keen and highly competent. He had a face that wouldn't look out of place in any boy band, all clean lines and a ready smile, but he had the build of a second row forward. Kray didn't believe in having favourites, but if she ever changed her mind, she knew he'd top the list.
Oh, sorry, Ros. I went outside to take your call, and when I got back, he blurted out.
What? What are you talking about?
The body, Ros, when I got back.
Kray barged past him into the vaulted hallway. She looked through the archway to the bottom of the stairs. It was empty. No detectives, no crime scene investigators, and no body.
Fuck,
Kray said as she spun on her heels.
I thought I made myself clear.
The signal in this house is shit. I had to go outside to take your call. When I got back in, they'd already taken the victim down.
Bollocks!
Kray slapped her hands against her sides and turned away. For all his 6'3" stature, Taverner looked like a naughty year 7 schoolboy. Kray regained her composure.
Okay, I'm sorry. I shouldn't have blown up like that.
By the time I got back, it was too late, Ros.
Kray took a deep breath.
You can help me walk through what happened.
They stepped across the aluminium plates to the bottom of the staircase.
You go first. What do you think of the sequence of events?
Kray asked.
Okay. The killer disables the victim, strips him and hangs him upside down. Then he tortures him by burning his skin and electrocuting him.
Taverner pointed to the disconnected power source for the telephone.
I reckon the killer used that socket.
Good, carry on.
Then, when the killer has had enough, he or she slashes the victim's neck and lets them bleed to death.
If you were the killer, where would you be when you were electrocuting the victim?
Oh, I suppose I'd be here. Taverner positioned himself at the foot of the stairs.
That's what I think, because if you are going to go to that much trouble, you would want to see the effects. What about the burning?
Oh, I don't know. Same thing, I guess. The killer would be facing the victim.
What next?
I stick him in the neck and he bleeds out.
The victim is stabbed on his right-hand side, which means...
Kray left the sentence unfinished for Taverner to fill in the gap. The victim is inverted, so that would make the killer right-handed.
That's what I thought originally.
How do you mean?
Think this through. I sever the carotid artery and jugular vein of a 15-stone man who was hanging upside down. If I don't move fast, I'm going to be ankle-deep in blood in no time. There are no shoe prints other than the ones left by the cleaner.
Well, he must have legged it.
But how do you explain the blood smear on the banister halfway up the stairs?
Taverner shook his head. The killer must have grabbed it, maybe when he was on his way out.
Kray moved around the stairs and reached her left hand into the air. It fell a good 2.5 feet short of the blood. The cogs whirred in Taverner's head.
But you're hardly normal.
Shut it, Kray said, not wanting to hear about her woeful lack of height. Even by the standards of your 6'3", you would have to raise your hand high in the air to make that mark. And who the hell runs away from a body gushing 13 pints of blood onto the floor with their hands in the air?
Well, fucking most people, I would have thought,
he said.
Kray fixed him with her best glare.
I get what you're saying, Roz. Taverner looked at Kray with a, come on then, tell me, look on his face. I think after the killer tortured the victim, he or she made their way up the stairs.
Kray shuffled past Taverner and sat on the fifth step.
The killer was behind the victim when he slashed his neck, which would make our killer left-handed.
He could have spun the vic around, slashed his neck and spun him back.
But the blood spatter does not support that. The killer stuck him with the knife and the blood hit woodwork.
Kray pointed to the dark red stain on the balustrade.
Once the guy is dead, the killer climbs up onto the banister and drops down to the other side, avoiding the pool of blood. But he fails to notice he has blood on his hand.
Why would the killer do that? It makes no sense.
You're right, it doesn't. It only makes sense if the killer was standing here for a reason.
Maybe he needed to go upstairs. Taverner's phone beeped in his pocket. He pulled it out and shouted into the handset. Yeah, wait until I get outside. He cupped the phone in his hands. I need to take this, Roz. And skipped along the floor plates, disappearing into the hallway. The place fell silent. The house was still. Kray closed her eyes. The scar running diagonally across her body began to itch again. She grasped onto the handrail, and she could see the inverted body hanging in front of her, large areas of skin peeling away from the flesh. She reached out with her free hand to touch the figure suspended from the landing above.
The killer climbed the stairs to do something with the body.
The puckered red line that started to the left of her navel, traversed her stomach and bisected her right breast, burned beneath her clothing. Every pinprick where the surgeon's needle sewed her skin back together was red hot.
You did something to the body. What did you do?
Kray's hand felt cold as it passed through the space where the victim's legs had been.
What did you do?
Kray could see the killer stood on the stairs. He had something in his hand.
What the hell is it?
Sorry about that, Roz. Taverner returned, breaking the moment. That was the guys back at the station. They've set up an incident room and are ready for the first briefing. Kray's knuckles were white beneath the blue latex glove. She steadied herself, gripping the banister. Roz, are you okay? The guys at the station are waiting. Kray opened her eyes and snapped back to reality.
I'll be out in a minute.
Taverner beetled off to start the car. She closed her eyes once more, but it was gone. Kray headed down the hallway to the waiting car. With every step she took, she uttered the word, fuck. Chapter 5.
It's Tuesday. I quite like Tuesdays. I drive through the gates and pull into my usual spot next to the entrance. It's grey and cold outside, and the clock on the dashboard says 10:40 a.m. I like to arrive early. The wind cuts through my shirt and chills my skin as I step from the car. I'm working a split shift today, which is fine. Some of the guys hate working them, because it screws your day up. But I don't mind. I push through the side door into the clinically white corridor and head towards the changing room. The place resonates with the sound of cheap locker doors opening and closing, the usual dawn chorus that greets you at the start of shift. I nod my good mornings while holding my wallet against the clocking on machine. The sensor recognizes me and emits a beep. I strip off my jeans and shoes, pick my prized possession wrapped in tissue from my pocket and drop it into the container. I should feel elated, but I have a headache, dulling my senses. The white work trousers and Wellington boots feel warm as I pull them on. I slip my head through the neck of a red plastic apron and tie it tightly about my waist. The gloves are still where I left them, folded in the front pocket. The rest of my personal belongings are placed into the locker and I close the door with a metallic clunk. I make my way down a second brightly lit corridor, looking forward to my day. I shove open a heavy white door and splosh my way through the sanitizing footbath into the main hall. The cacophony of noise assaults my ears, while the stink of meat and steam hits me in the back of the throat. The squeal of a bandsaw tears through the air every 30 seconds like a metronome. I wander down the cordoned-off walkway to High Care, a bizarre name for such a place. I pass through two more sets of doors and arrive at the rear of the building. I can hear a delivery as it backs up to the unloading bay. The heavy doors of the wagon bang open against their hinges. I reach my workplace and enter a small room. It is 8 feet square with stainless steel walls and a grey resin floor that slopes away to a drain in the corner. I twitch the isolator switch a quarter turn clockwise, and the red LED lamp bursts into life on the control panel. I run through the safety checks. I can hear my first customers being driven from the lorry and corralled into pens. They know something is up. I can sense it's not going to be a good day. The sound is getting louder, and I open up the door at the back of the room to see 10 of them advancing towards me, hustling and bustling their way down the increasingly narrow walkway. A big one is leading the charge. There is a whoosh of compressed air and a metal gate closes behind them. I allow them to settle, then usher the big one into my room and close the door. She spins around, expecting to see the others following in hot pursuit, rotating on the spot when she realizes...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.